President Trump blocking Hope Hicks from handing over documents to Congress, documents required under subpoena. Hope Hicks' attorney tonight saying in a new letter to Congress the documents could fall under executive privilege. Now, keep in mind, Hicks is crucial. She's as inner circle for Trump as it gets. She was a witness to some of the most controversial moments in Mueller's report. And that is why Democrats investigating obstruction want her to hand over documents from her time at the White House. And the deadline is tonight. But Hicks tonight is not the only star witness Trump is trying to keep quiet. The White House also blocking former White House counsel Don McGahn's chief of staff from cooperating, Annie Donaldson. Her notes were quoted extensively in the Mueller report, central to it. And at this hour, the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee, Jerry Nadler, in a statement, says this is all evidence of the president's continued obstruction of congressional investigations. And some Democrats tonight are taking it further.
He is a total obstruction, no witnesses, no talk, no documents, just kind of like the mob.
Do you think it's time to open up an impeachment inquiry into the president?
Long past time.
That was Representative Lloyd Doggett. And long past time, he says, well, the House Speaker Nancy Pelosi is now staring down a growing insurgency inside her own party. The number of Democrats are calling for impeachment, you can see on your screen. It is growing every day. We are now up to 59. So how long can Pelosi keep everyone at bay? It may not be much longer if you ask Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
Do you sense on impeachment some restlessness among your fellow Democrats?
I think so.
Pamela Brown is traveling with the president in London tonight, where she is out front live. Pamela, Hope Hicks, Annie Donaldson, the latest to be blocked by the White House. They are very important star witnesses. And obviously, this is the way the White House is playing. They're playing tough down to the bottom line.
That's absolutely right. This is a pattern from the White House directing former White House officials to not comply with some of the requests from House committees from Democrats. So this will only ratchet up the tension between the two branches of government. And in this latest example today, the White House has directed Hope Hicks, who was a former White House official, a close advisor to President Trump, and the deputy White House counsel, Ann Donaldson, to not turn over documents to the House Judiciary Committee during their time at the White House. White House counsel Pat Cipollone arguing that those documents could fall under confidentiality, that they could be subject to executive privilege concerns. And so in both of these cases, Ann Donaldson and Hope Hicks are abiding by that. Now, the committee does say, through Jerry Nadler, the chairman, that Hope Hicks has worked out a deal. Well, she will be providing some documents relating to the campaign. Of course, the White House does not have jurisdiction over campaign documents. But certainly, Jerry Nadler is now saying that he could hold Hope Hicks and Ann Donaldson in contempt. Another interesting part of this is that the White House pointed to DOJ, saying, you're working with DOJ to get some of these documents that you're asking for. Why don't you see this process through? DOJ wrote a letter to the committee today saying, look, we'll hand over some of these documents to you, a limited number, if you no longer, if you don't hold this vote to hold the attorney general in contempt. Jerry Nadler said, absolutely. Absolutely not, that he'll continue to talk with DOJ, but that the contempt vote will still be held. So you're seeing this back and forth play out. And this is just over documents, Erin. We haven't even gotten to the testimony yet for these two witnesses in the Mueller probe, Ann Donaldson and Hope Hicks. That's at a later date. But this follows, of course, blocking the testimony and documents from former White House counsel Don McGahn. Erin?
All right, Pamela, thank you very much. And let's go now to Democratic Congresswoman Jackie Speier, who is on the House Intelligence and Oversight Committees. Congresswoman, good to have you back. So,
thank you, Erin.
What should happen now? Hope Hicks, Annie Donaldson, you know, the attorneys are saying, look, they're going to try the executive privilege thing here. They're going to abide by what the White House wants, which is keep quiet, defy a subpoena. Should they be held in contempt?
Yes, they should be held in contempt. You know, we have been operating with white gloves while the president has been operating with boxing gloves. And it's time for us to take the white gloves off and put on the boxing gloves as well. We are a co-equal branch of government. We have the responsibility of oversight. We have the responsibility to access these documents and to hear from these individuals. They have waived any privilege, any executive privilege associated with their relationship with Donald Trump because they actually participated in the special counsel's investigation. So it's time for us to get really serious about this. This is an individual who has violated every principle of the Constitution. And he does it consistently, and we sit back and don't take the kind of firm action we should be taking. Now, I would also argue that we should be pursuing inherent contempt. If we pursue civil contempt, it will go on for years. Look at Eric Holder. That went on for 6 years. It was just a negotiated settlement 3 weeks ago. So we need to take action as an equal, co-equal branch of government and get these materials that we need.
And inherent contempt, you're saying you could move immediately.
We could move immediately. They could come to the House floor. Forget the jail, forget the shackles, just start fining them $25,000 a day, and then we will have some cooperation.
I would imagine you would with that. So when you say that you need to take firm action, obviously you have said you supported starting the impeachment process. The speaker, though, is not there. I don't know if you just heard Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, talking about Democrats growing restless, that swing state members are starting to hear from their constituents about this. Are you hearing from your constituents? Do you think Pelosi is going to move?
I think that the speaker will move when she believes she has a majority of the members of her caucus and that the 40 members that are in play here will be protected. But I've got to tell you, I am tired of us looking at this as if this is a political chess game. Mm-hmm. I am not a campaign consultant. I'm a member of Congress. I have an obligation to swear under oath that I will protect and defend the Constitution of the United States. This president is obstructing justice. He obstructs it as a private citizen. He's obstructed justice as a candidate. He's obstructed justice as a president of the United States at least 11 times based on the special counsel's analysis. He wants to have the Department of Justice go after his enemies like we're some banana republic, whether it is Joe Biden or Hillary Clinton. We've got to recognize what's going on here.
Does the speaker agree with you, though, when you talk? Because it sounds like, look, she's got to manage her people and get her people there. I understand that. That's the job of a speaker. However, she's talked about impeachment being divisive for the country, which may be true, but certainly sounds more like based on politics or a different evaluation of the situation than just pure principle and constitutionality. Does she agree with you behind closed doors that this is the right thing to do and just others aren't there yet, or is she not even agree with you behind closed doors?
I think that she has basically said she wants overwhelming evidence. I think we have an avalanche of evidence now, and it grows day by day. So the American people want us to do our job. Our job is to protect this Constitution, protect this institution, and I think by starting an impeachment inquiry, regardless of whether the Senate takes it up or not, we need to lay out the facts to the American people. They're not going to read the Mueller report. That's not their job. That's our job.
So I want to just take one pause here, if I may, Congresswoman, and I'm going to get your reaction to this. But Pamela is coming back in here with some breaking news. I know, Pamela, you just spoke exclusively with a British official, high-ranking Minister of State for Security, and you just asked him about claims that Trump has repeated that British intelligence helped Obama spy on the Trump campaign. What are you learning at this hour?
That's right. I asked Ben Wallace, the security minister here in the UK, about these allegations that the president has repeated that he believes the Brits spied on his campaign. Now, Ben Wallace oversees the intelligence agencies here in the UK, and he works closely with U.S. intelligence agencies. And while he didn't want to comment specifically on intelligence sharing, he did say that the Brits don't have the resources and the capacity to spy on a friend, on an ally like the United States, particularly a presidential campaign. He said, if you really want to learn about American politics, you can just turn on the news because there are so many other important priorities here in Great Britain. Here's what he said.
In the days of social media, there's an awful lot of speculation that goes on about these things. There is no big conspiracy. And the idea that I would take an intelligence officer off a job of, I don't know, targeting Al-Qaeda in a place that's of mutual issues to us, to put him on spying on a campaign of a presidential candidate, I think is just it's not going to be the reality.
So that sentiment denying this echoes what we've heard from other British officials. It was interesting, Erin, today at the joint press conference, the president said that there was incredible intelligence sharing between the UK and the US, but he did not talk about his concerns today about this idea that the Brits spied on his campaign. He's made those claims without providing any evidence, and this official saying flatly that that just didn't happen, Erin.
All right. Thank you very much, Pamela. And, of course, Congresswoman, if there was any intelligence picked up, it was, it would appear, listening to foreign nationals, Russians perhaps, who happened to be talking to people on the Trump campaign, which is very different than spying on the campaign itself. What's your reaction to what the Brits are saying, that they're just dismissing this whole idea, which the president keeps raising out of hand?
The president keeps raising it because he's paranoid and he loves to project as opposed to take any responsibility. We share intelligence with Five Eyes, as they're referred to. That's the UK, it's Canada, it's New Zealand, it's Australia. We share intelligence with our friends and allies all the time. But the only reason that the UK would have shared any information would be if it had to do with Russia and Russia's intervention in our election. And that's precisely what happened.
All right. Congresswoman, I appreciate your time. Thanks.
Thank you, Erin.